is Covering the Spread. Here are your hosts, Jim Saunas and Dr. Ed Feng.
What is going on, everybody? Welcome on into Covering the Spread. That's right here on the FanDuel Podcast Network and numberfire.com as we're taking a look at some men's college basketball tournaments, breaking down the conference tourneys and where we can find some value with Andy Molitor of the Deep Dive Podcast. My name is Jim Saunas. I am a senior writer and analyst for numberfire.com, joined here as always by Ed Feng. You can find his work over at thepowerrank.com and on Twitter at thepowerrank. Ed, you have a busy week this week because the Sloan Analytics Conference is going down in Boston. So how are you doing today?
I'm doing great. I'm busting my butt trying to get all the March Madness stuff together. And then I take off Thursday for Boston. It's my yearly pilgrimage. I don't know if it's year 11 or 12, but it's in a row. But it's been many years in a row. So
on your podcast, you do a good job of talking about food. Have you ever ventured across the river to like Cambridge? I guess no, MIT's.
Yeah.
I guess they host it in downtown Boston. But have you ever ventured across the river to go to Cambridge while you're out there at Sloan?
Yeah, actually, I've been to Mead Hall the past two.
Yes. Oh
years.
My gosh, that's what I was going to recommend. So weirdly, because you're a Midwesterner, I feel okay. I guess now you're a Midwesterner. I feel okay divulging the fact that I have a weird obsession with ranch dressing. The ranch dressing at Mead Hall is the most delicious ranch dressing I have had in my entire life. So you need to go there. Other one is Four Horses Tavern? Four or five horses.
I've been there, but yeah, I think I've heard of it.
They have skillet cornbread. It tastes like candy, basically.
Nice.
And you need that. So go back to Mead Hall, first of all, get some ranch dressing. Right. And then go to four or five horses and get the cornbread and a duck burrito. And then you're set.
Okay.
Duck burrito is probably the better recommendation than the cornbread. But you got to talk to the Sloan guys about getting it not so close to March Madness. So you're not dying for these couple of weeks.
Yeah, but I mean, it's also good to talk to people right before March Madness and remind them that I exist and tell them about the podcast series I'm doing on my podcast this year. Which I am doing. I'm going to do Bracket Wisdom on the Football Analytics Show this year. It's going to launch Monday, March 9th. But I just wanted to bring up Mead Hall again because the reason I know about that is because some dudes were hanging out there one year. This may have been 4 or 5 years ago. And they were a bunch of bettors. And what a lot of bettors do is they show up at the conference and don't buy a ticket and just hang out.
Yeah.
Which is honestly a pretty good idea.
Smart.
I got a friend coming in that's staying with me that's going to do that because, one, the conference is very expensive.
Correct.
And two, sometimes the tickets sell out. And you can get a lot from just the people that are hanging out. I mean, there's always a Thursday night gathering of the basketball analytics folks at Fours, which basically everyone goes to now. So if you're listening to this, I mean, I'll be at Fours on Thursday night unless I die before then.
I assume Keith Goldner will be there too. He brought us there a couple years ago. So,
right. So Keith is usually there. Rufus is always there. Probably a bunch of other people that we've had on the show as well. a lot of people just come to hang out because, you know, it's just a good chance to see their friends. And, the conference is worthwhile to me. I'm never much of a talk kind of guy, but I do enjoy all the people that are there and chatting with people. And you just never know who's going to show up and make things interesting. So it's always a good time heading off there this week, and I'll let you know how it goes.
And Mead Hall has that nice second floor. We were there for it was an alumni event. I don't know why there would be an alumni event in Boston because I did not go to school near Boston. But it was in November of 2016 and nobody was in a good mood. But it was still fun because it was Mead Hall. So recommend you go back there.
I mean, you haven't even mentioned the reason why most people go to Mead Hall.
For the beer, I assume?
Yeah, the beer selection.
It's ranch dressing one, ranch dressing two, and then beer three to me. You need to realize my priorities revolve around ranch dressing.
There you go. Well, I'm the opposite. The beer selection is pretty awesome.
It is.
And Maine Brewing Company has a bunch of really good IPAs, and they started distributing in bars in Boston last year, which makes the trip even better. So lunch and dinner are just phenomenal IPAs.
Are you an IPA guy?
Yep.
Okay. Did not know that.
Absolutely.
It's not an IPA, but while you're in the Northeast, I can just unload all my Northeast knowledge, which is very limited because I didn't leave the house while I was there. because it's very expensive to leave the house while I was in Boston. Try to find Switchback. It's a Vermont beer from Burlington, Vermont. And I have found it a couple of times in Boston. We went to the brewery when we were in Burlington once. But every time we find it in Boston, I found it once in Syracuse. But it has like, it's like the same bottle as like Red Stripe, which is always fun because it's like novel. Nice. But like the beer is amazing. So find Switchback, get ranch dressing from Mead Hall, and get a duck burrito from the whatever number of horses it may be place. The official recommendations, for sure. We're going to get Andy Molitor in, and I was talking with that about Boston, which where I used to live. Andy is also in a place where I used to live. He is right outside my hometown. We'll talk about that. Find Andy on Twitter, at AndyMSFW. Again, he is the co-host of the Deep Dive podcast. You probably know Whale Capper from the times we've had him on. Andy is a co-host of Whale Capper, and it's always nice for me because Andy has a Minnesota accent, and I miss Minnesota accents with most of my heart. And getting to listen to Andy talk with Whale Capper, I get the good insights from both of them, but also I get my Minnesota accent fix, which is deeply needed, almost as much as my ranch dressing. So make sure you follow Andy on Twitter and check out the Deep Dive podcast. We're going to break down men's college basketball conference tournaments, which kick off this week, his betting model, what he looks for in mid-majors that could surge, and all that stuff. To make sure you get every podcast here on Covering the Spread, make sure you are subscribed because we're going to have plenty of tourney talk coming up the next couple of weeks as well. Just search for Covering the Spread wherever you get your podcasts. Subscribe, rate, and review, and we thank you, those of you who have done so already. Now, before we bring on Andy, I gotta put my tail between my legs and walk off and go back through the XFL bet from last week because, oh boy, it was a doozy.
Covering the past.
All right, Ed. So last week I had the XFL in my Covering the Future segment for the second time this year. And for the second time this year, it went horribly, so I am officially retiring from betting on the XFL. If I try to talk about it, hit me. Like, slap me virtually. Or whatever you need to do, don't let it happen because it was bad.
Or I might give you a lecture on small sample size of, three bets?
Two. That's better, though. Two. I think I'm going to take your view. That's also, I'll take that. We got good closing line value. I had the DC Defenders minus one against the Tampa Bay Vipers. The thought process for me was that the line was overreacting to week three with the Defenders flopping, Cardale Jones throwing four picks, and the Vipers finally showed life. Got the good line movement. They closed at, I think it was like five, so like 4 points of value. That was positive. The game was not. They did not score a single point. They got shut out 25-0. It was a bloodbath. Cardale Jones was, I don't remember what year the championship run was for OSU. Was the year after that where he got benched for JT Barrett. That was the Cardale Jones we saw there. Complete reversal the first 2 weeks. The Vipers defense made some big strides from where it was previously, so that bet sucked. My future bet before the season also sucked, so I'm out. You can give me the small sample size lecture if you want, but I'm out. Until I get a good read, I'm done. I'm finished. Never touching this thing ever again.
Well, first of all, if you're listening to the show and you lose two bets in a row, don't freak out. But secondly, I mean, we're talking about Cardale Jones, and that just reminded me of a little bit of analysis I did kind of in my head over the fall, in terms of teams that have won the national championship, that name is not Alabama.
Yeah.
And all of them have an NFL quarterback, except for that Ohio State team.
Mm-hmm.
So, and you talked about how, you know, Cardale Jones had a great three games, right? I remember spending a lot of time figuring out how I had to adjust Ohio State's number against Alabama. I think he started against Wisconsin in the Big Ten championship game. He was amazing over three games. And then couldn't win the job the next year against JT Barrett. So, you know, again, small sample size, right? I mean, that was an incredible fluke. I mean, a fluke, I don't know, just an outlier performance for three games from Cardale Jones. I mean, I'm not saying he's terrible, but he's certainly not in the NFL. And usually you need an NFL caliber quarterback to win a college football title.
I remember panicking after that stretch for Cardale where it looked like he was going to come out for the draft, because each year for numberFire, I write a breakdown of the top quarterbacks in the draft statistically. And like a lot of it is based on experience. Like the more experience you have relative to your age, the the more likely you are to not bust, basically.
Right.
He had three starts or three games with 10 pass attempts or whatever it was. And the low is, I think it might be Dwayne Haskins now at like 15. So like, but it was Mark Sanchez at 16 before that. So there was no precedent for a guy with that small of a sample ever translating to NFL success. So I was like, oh my gosh, how do I defend the fact that I'm not going to like Cardale Jones to like people? Because like people yell at me on Twitter. Like I got yelled at for Deshaun Kizer, not liking him. Like people yell at very weird things. But I was like, oh man, I'm going to be very low on him. People are going to like hate on me. And like, I was so relieved when he announced he was coming back because I just got to avoid this massive, massive headache. That was my main motivation, was avoiding the headache.
I think there's a really good reason why you look at number of starts.
Yeah.
Like coaches know what they're doing, right? They see things in practice and they're going to put the best guy out there. There's a reason Cardale Jones was a third stringer. Even when Mitchell Trubisky was drafted.
Williams is in the XFL, by the way. Why he was starting over Mitchell Trubisky.
Doesn't have a single NFL start.
That's right.
And Mitchell Trubisky was that good. How come he couldn't beat him out the year before, right?
Yep.
Trubisky started 1 year at North Carolina. Obviously had a strong arm and a lot of physical attributes, but ask yourself the question, like, why couldn't he beat out a guy that, you know, isn't a good NFL quarterback?
Right. And if you were to point out one concern with Joe Burrow, it's that one. Also lower experience, age 20, coming off his age 23 season. I like Joe Burrow and I want to make that clear. But if you were to have a red flag there, it would be that for sure.
Yeah. And I think that's balanced with, you know, I mean, he does have 2 years as a starter.
True.
And he's got eight games that were not greatish and then four games that were pretty good. And then probably some of the best quarterbacking we've seen in college football.
Absolutely.
So that, I mean, that probably makes Burrow, you know, the hardest, right?
Yeah. Absolutely. And like, it's tough because like age matters a lot too. And he's coming off his age 23 season.
Right.
Slightly concerning, but like, again, when you watch the guy, it's really hard for me to have like any real concerns. Cause like, he was so good against such a tough schedule.
And he's projected number one, right?
Yep. Pretty much a no doubter. They've taken it off the board at FanDuel Sportsbook because like, I think it's just such a lock at this point. So I will never argue against Joe Burrow, but if you were to do so, that would be your main argument. It would be not starting, older, inexperienced, and Cardale Jones. Oh boy, just locking me out of the XFL forever.
I mean, it'd be interesting to see, you know, what Urban Meyer or whoever the OC was that year would say about him now.
Yeah, I would be very interested in that too, because, like you said, coaches know what they're doing. The NFL knows what they're doing, too. Like, draft stock matters so much for which quarterbacks pan out.
Exactly.
Because, like, I liked Drew Locke a lot last year, but the fact that he fell in the second round lowers his odds of hitting significantly. So these people are good at what they're doing. We should trust some of their judgment for sure. So instead of having me talk about the XFL, we're going to bring in Andy Molitor here in just 1 second. But first, if you want to get in on the action, check out the FanDuel Sportsbook and place your first bet today. If you lose, FanDuel will give you a refund of up to $500 in site credit. Visit sportsbook.fanduel.com for more details. Terms and conditions apply. Must be 21 plus and physically present in New Jersey, Pennsylvania, West Virginia, or Indiana. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER. Let's bring on Andy Molitor now. Find him on Twitter at AndyMSFW. He is one of the co-hosts on the Deep Dive podcast. We're going to talk some men's college basketball conference tournaments, get his thoughts there, and of course, I'm going to pick Andy's brain on southeastern Minnesota as well.
Covering the present.
We're now joined here by Andy Molitor, the other side of the Deep Dive podcast. We've had Whale Capper on like a bunch of times, and we gotta cover all the bases here on the Deep Dive podcast. So, Andy, welcome to the show. How are you doing today?
Pretty good. It's exciting times. This is March. This is March, Joe.
Exactly.
Finally, we had to wait an extra day this year, but
Andy Rothstein, we'll call you. Yeah.
Yes. Cease and desist letter from him.
But Andy, we were talking before the show, and I am from a tiny, tiny, tiny town in Minnesota, and you are talking to us right now from a town 15 miles away. You are in Rochester. I am from Cassin, and this is blowing my mind that I get to talk to someone from the 507 on a podcast about this. So you're making my day, and I hope you know that.
Yeah, I stopped at the Burger King over in Cassin. It's still terrible. Like it's
not always good, has been. The Quick Trip though cannot be slandered.
You cannot slander any Quick Trip.
That's
just
right.
Top customer service there. I love those places. But yeah, no, beautiful little chunk of Minnesota down here, southeastern Minnesota. That's weird that I knew you're from the area. I didn't know you were that close. So pretty cool. Yeah.
We got some high school wrestling talk in before and everything. So maybe we'll I don't think we can get any markets on those. But once those are available, we're gonna have to bring you back, Andy.
With legalization in Iowa,
right?
That's huge down there. You someday. Okay.
Just go to Diamond Joe. You're good. You know, absolutely. Just a short little bop down there. We'll see what we can get working there for sure. But never fade the cast of Manville Comets. I can tell you that for sure. Now, Andy, the reason we wanted you on today, outside of me indulging in some Minnesota talk, is that your betting process, since teams are centered around betting mid-majors, men's college basketball, and that's a unique skill set, you know, from a betting perspective. So what about mid-majors do you think allows you to be more successful in those markets?
I just think maybe less information going into the market. As far even as you get down later in the season, you know, you'll see people say that about any sport. Oh, the lines are tighter. The lines are sharpening up. And, I mean, it's something everyone says, but it's kind of true as well, especially like in the NFL. I mean, just more and more information is poured into the market via stats and just the results of the games, but also by the people who are betting into it. They're giving the books the information, and it's the same kind of thing in any sport. And I think in a lot of these smaller leagues, they're just so small of a handle. And we did talk to on the deep dive a few weeks ago, we talked to a bookmaker about that, and he pretty much said that there's even in general during the week, even on some of the big games, the handle in college basketball is obviously nowhere near NFL levels. And I just think some of these numbers can be wildly off. Like, I'm not even going to say how far off I have some of these that I make it, because it's laughable. I almost feel bad about my model sometimes. It's like maybe I need to fix this. Like, it can't be off by that much, but it does pretty well. And I enjoy those games too. And it's become kind of a shtick where like one team every year will be a team that just does not get adjusted. Maybe they're not covering, you know, huge. They're just continuing to stay within the number, but they're never, you know, blowing out a team they were a dog to. And the market just never adjusts for it. And I end up betting, like, you know, a team 15 times during a season, which is a lot. And last year was the Pepperdine, I think, Waves. I think so, out in Malibu. They just never adjusted. I kept pounding on Pepperdine. I did really well with them. This year, not so close to the ocean, but on the water there, the Niagara Purple Eagles, just every week. Like, I know, if they're an underdog in this game, my model's going to make them like a 2-point favorite. I'm going to have to bet it every time. So it does become kind of fun just knowing ahead of time before the numbers even come out. I'm probably going to be in on some of these teams.
Excellent, Andy. Tell us a little bit about the model that you have that you mentioned. I know it's, you know, college basketball, there's a lot of different team strengths. What are you doing with this model?
Yeah, it's just, a lot of the stats are super widely available for a lot of these teams, and it's just been a lot of toying with it. It's not, you know, it's not something static that I've done exactly the same from the beginning. I've changed a lot of stuff, but and you go to team rankings and KenPom, I mean, you could stop right there. And there's so much information about all these teams, and then when you get down to it, there's 350 some teams. There's a lot of disparity between a lot of these teams and some of those. And if you start doing some back testing and looking at the weighting of maybe what you think matters, and then looking back and seeing if it actually does, you can start adjusting your weighting. And like, honestly, I've been working on getting a little better at some coding, but I'm still working 100% out of Excel. So it's a big, my model is just a really, really big Excel spreadsheet. It's become quite bulky at this point, and someday it's all going to move over. But for now, it's just, you know, it's changing the weighting on a lot of these stats. Now I use them and seeing how my numbers match up against the market every single day. And, well, 3 o'clock comes, 3 o'clock central, those lines come out, and I have my numbers made, I punch them in, and then we start digging in.
Yeah, I mean, code is to make your life easier, and Excel makes your life easier. I mean, you don't have to do multiplication for all 353 teams and do the weighing, so there's nothing wrong with, you know, using Excel for that. Andy, also the conference tournaments, I think, start today. Are you looking to bet those in terms of individual games, or maybe the futures market for who's going to win those tournaments?
So I do write previews for all 26 that aren't the major ones. I did that last year. It started out as, the point I'm starting to make here is they're so goofy. Like they are all so goofy. Like some are home sites, tie seed sites, some are top seeds until you get to the semifinals, then it's a neutral site. I started looking at that last year. I'm like, I'm lost. Like I'm gonna get so lost here in where these teams are playing. I started writing down like every tournament where what the rules were for it, just so I could bet them. And then I'm like, well, I might as well just put these out. Because I'm already doing like 3/4 of an article for every one of these conferences. So I will bet those games. But I mean, that was the point I was trying to make, is you really do have to be careful when you're betting those games, knowing like, well, first off, where is this game played? Because there's so much neutral. And I mean, there'll be neutral site stuff that's set up years in advance, and it'll turn out one of the top teams, that's their home gym. Mm-hmm. Or in Charleston, one of the years, Charleston played in a gym across town. So it wasn't a home gym. So it said this is in Charleston, but it's not technically a home gym. There's so much goofiness. So I will bet those games. But I implore people to kind of be careful with that and figure out what's going on.
Do you have that game? Do you have that write-up available for this year too?
Yep, I have the first four out. I've just been posting those on my Twitter. So I did... Okay. The first four that came out today, I'm working on the next three. There's three more tournaments that start tomorrow. It's kind of a blitz right at the beginning. There's like 8-9 tournaments in the first 3 days.
Okay, so if you want to find that, go to @AndyMSFW on Twitter to find those breakdowns. But that is like, that's a pretty key thing. And if we as bettors are having a hard time keeping up with it, the books probably aren't necessarily totally on top of everything either, which kind of goes back to what you were talking about, where they may not put as much of an effort into it, which can give you a bigger edge as a bettor. So do you find the intricacies of the tournaments give you an upper hand in just another way where you may be accounting for something more so than the books are?
Yeah, and that's something you can do, looking into, like I said, the style of the tournament. Medcalf over at Circa, he said that to me on Twitter. We were looking for prices to come out, and Circa was one of the first ones. And he said they did the Atlantic Sun before the Horizon, because some just have an 8-team bracket where, you know, it's a pretty standard single elimination. Whereas the Horizon, I mean, I don't even think we have time to get into it. It's wild reseedings, and like there's extra, all these pigtails and stuff, and then they reseed multiple times. It's goofy. Like, I can't imagine trying to put out futures, trying to figure out, like, you won't even know who some of these teams are going to play down the road. So, like, kudos for anybody putting out prices on that. But like you said, I think if you dig in, you might be able to find some angles that maybe aren't there, the books aren't accounting for, and some of those things.
Kudos and condolences, I think, are both in store there for bookmakers there. Now, let's talk about some individual teams here. When you're looking at markets right now for the conference tournaments beginning this week, and they're not, you know, we don't have like futures for individual conference tournaments on FanDuel, so you can go wherever you want. But are there any teams that stick out to you as being undervalued right now by the market?
Yeah, and I think, I mean, you start with the inverse part of that, the overvalued teams.
Yeah.
Like when you have an overvalued team in a conference, you're going to have some value elsewhere. And I mean, right away, Liberty. I mean, I think people are just going to look, maybe what would be the first thing, you know, a novice bettor might do when they're getting into a conference tournament, maybe look at the standings. And Liberty has 27 wins. They're a good team, but there's still quite a bit of parity in that league up in the Atlantic Sun. And I definitely think there's some value on like North Florida. I think that got hit pretty hard, actually. And even Lipscomb, that's a team that they were in the finals last year. They actually hosted the finals last year. So there's definitely some value to be had on some of these lower teams, especially when you have maybe a favorite that's going to be a little more pricey just based on record or flashiness, or even like a known name, like, I don't know, a team that makes the tournament every year out of that conference. And maybe people don't follow something like the Patriot League, but they've heard of Colgate because they're taking them plus 24 in the tournament, the big tournament, first round, you know, every year facing like North Carolina or something. So, you know, you get those known teams. Sometimes there's a shade of overvalued.
That's interesting. I mean, that kind of suggests there's a lot of public money out there for people who don't really know what they're talking about and just betting something that they know a little bit. Andy, I wanted to ask you real quick, Dayton and San Diego State have had fantastic seasons. San Diego State might even get a one seed. What do you have any takes on these teams and how deep they could potentially go in the tournament?
Yeah, this is something I've really had trouble with. And this is something from the get-go my model struggles with. Like these teams that are in a mid-major conference that become outliers, like within, you know, there are so many miles ahead of a lot of the teams within their conference or in the mid-major market in general that, like, when I run numbers, it just doesn't jive. It says bet against Gonzaga every time. San Diego State, right. Like, it's like 6 points off. You should bet against them every time. They're so good in their conferences that my numbers don't make sense to them. And then on the other side of things, they don't really play anybody. So it's really hard to gauge how these teams play when they get into some of this, you know, the high-level competition they're going to face once they get into the big dance. I definitely think, you know, they're all second-weekend teams for sure. I don't think they're so overrated that they'll be flaming out in the first round or something. But it would be tough for me to imagine, like, San Diego State or Dayton in the Final Four with just how wide open this year is. There's so many good teams, I mean, throughout the top 20, and a lot of them are blue bloods with experienced coaches, just, you know, maybe a little even, you know, intimidation factor. You go up and you're in the regional final against a Duke or a Kentucky or one of the blue bloods like that. That's tough for a team like Dayton or San Diego State who hasn't been there much. I mean, Dayton used to be the team that always got the first four. They got like, oh, everybody's like, oh, we got to bet them because the first four, it's in Dayton.
Yeah.
I don't think they
because they get a
they
central home
game,
right?
Games. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. That was baked in, turned out.
Yeah. So with Dayton, is that a team that you might be viewing as potentially primed to be overvalued for their conference tournament as well? Or is this more so projecting them out for the NCAA tournament? Are you looking to potentially fade them in the conference tournament as well? Or is this more so just for the big dance?
No, I definitely, and it'll be price dependent when those come out. Obviously, all the prices aren't out for the conference tournaments. They're slowly leaking out as they start, but I think, you know, like I said with Liberty, I was expecting a much lower number. I was fully prepared to bet Liberty if the number was right, and then it came out much different from where I thought it was going to be, and I said, I got to go a different direction. I'm going completely opposite. So, I mean, it's going to be price dependent, but I think there is always room to fade those teams. You can even find some two-way markets on some of the favorites like that where it'll just be, say, hey, it's a the field versus this top team, the field versus Dayton, the field versus San Diego State. And when a team is like -300-400 to win the conference, you can get a pretty nice number and you're getting a dozen teams. You're basically getting, will they screw up at some point? The only one I don't love to do that with is Gonzaga they have a very goofy conference tournament where they get a triple bye. So they only have to play like two games. So that's awful tough. But definitely the other conference tournaments, there's some room to be fading those teams.
Yeah, I mean, I think as good as Gonzaga is, like St. Mary's and BYU are pretty good basketball teams. And I can definitely see them tripping up against one of those teams.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, so they have a little more competition this year. That'll be a fun one.
Yeah. It should be interesting, and Gonzaga is always fun to watch too, which doesn't hurt there. You mentioned that markets have been a little bit slow to come out, so it's possible there's not a whole lot we can bank on right now, but any other bets you're looking to lock in right now for the conference tournaments that are starting this week?
Yeah, I mean, I will bet almost every single tournament. In fact, I will. I mean, just for those articles, like I said,
you put the work in, might as well. Yeah, you know,
I got like the third one last year, and I said, am I going to bet every one of these? Like, do I have to put something? I'm like, you know what? I'm going to put something small. Like, this is the right thing's value. So, you know, in the other leagues, I did take some small flyers, and I did take one of those field bets. You know, I definitely. I'm trying to look back at actually which one that was, but I did take a field bet just because I thought somebody was overvalued. I'm going to pull that up. There was four of them so far that have started. And like I said, in the Atlantic Sun, I just took a couple of the lower teams. And I mean, maybe that field bet was the look, but it was Colgate and the Patriot. I can get +120. And I like that a lot because they're a really good team, but there's just this glut through the middle of like decent teams. There's a couple teams that have beat them, and I think they are just a little overvalued. And I like that a lot if you can get a two-way market or just start taking a few of the longer shots in that Patriot League. It's a really small conference. You know, you can have a lot of goofiness in something like that.
Sounds good. So, Andy, while we're here, let's talk some golf and XFL as well. Arnold Palmer Invitational this week, and Rory McIlroy is a pretty massive favorite at plus 550. Any thoughts on this tournament and anything you're betting?
Yeah, I was super disappointed when they ran my numbers because he went right to the top. Like he's probably priced where he should be. Like I have him as my top ranked golfer, and when I put together the stats I wanted to look at for this week, his course history here is electric. He's been playing decent. He's Rory. He's good. I still don't think I'm going to take. I'm still not laying. You know, I don't want to say laying because it's not like I'm minus 110 to bet Rory versus the field, but it's still not big enough number. I have a few other guys that came near the top. I'm probably going to get on some Bryson. Just he owes me money. Congrats. I know some people. I know a lot of people that had Patrick Reed, and
we have him on this podcast actually from the WGC Mexico.
Okay, yeah. I did. I heard that the other episode. I listen to you guys when I get the chance.
Nice.
But thanks. Yeah, I know. I made me laugh with the Chuck Knoblauch hot dog story. I definitely remember that. But back to golf. Yeah, Patrick Reed, I have a soft spot. I bet him in the Masters at 50-1 when he got his jacket. So I can't hate on the guy, but man, that sucked. Because I usually will bet a few outrights, and I only took one shot that week. It was Bryson, that was it. And boy, if you can hit a one outright and lock it in and get it to cash for you, that feels so good. And I thought we had that in the bag. That was rough. But yeah, he's just, I go across all the stats I used, all around golfer. Like he's hitting all the high notes for me. I can't even at 16-1. It's not a huge number, but I like it enough where I'm going to take some of him. I mean, Matsuyama, Xander, a few of the other guys. You know, they're at the top for me, but I didn't love some of the numbers. They have a few weaknesses that maybe are a little much for me to overcome, even though they are popping towards the top. I will take some long shots here too. I'm pretty much embedding Morikawa and Hovland every week.
Might as well.
Like those are just my guys. Like the ball striking so pure, and they do other things well too. Like they're avoiding bogeys. They're winners. They're going to win eventually, and they have bigger numbers. They're both like 45. I think I pulled the FanDuel numbers. It was 45 for Morikawa, 48 for Hovland, and then Matthew. I'm not even good at this guy's name. Neesmith.
Yeah, Neesmith. So I spent 10 minutes last week trying to figure out his pronunciation, and then I found out it's literally in his Twitter handle. His Twitter handle is K-N-E-E Smith. I was so mad when I saw that it's literally in his Twitter handle. It is Neesmith. I was so mad about him last week. I was, like, intrigued by him, but I was still very angry. But yes, I know your pain here. You're good.
Oh, I know. I do a tennis podcast, and there's times where I have to, like, you find a YouTube video and you want to hear the announcer say it. Like, so you can try to get the name right.
I've done that, 100%.
Neesmith, top 10 bogey avoidance guy. He's a decent ball striker, putt's okay. Like, at 100-1, I'm taking some of him. He's the guy who's won tournaments down on the Corn Ferry, and he just, whenever I see a guy like that where you look at the price for fantasy or daily fantasy price that pops up on here, and when there's a really low number there, you got to start looking like, oh man, this guy's like 100-150-1 guy for sure. I'm gonna have to definitely take a look at that. And yeah, Neesmith, couple bucks at 100-1.
I dig that. Okay. The other thing with Neesmith is you were talking about looking at YouTube videos to try to figure out like pronunciations, and I did that with Matthew Neesmith, and I didn't actually hear the pronunciation of his name. All I heard was him talking about shaving his goatee, so I tried to go the YouTube route, but it didn't actually work, unfortunately. So you were talking about guys who would just come up from the other tours, talking about Hovland, talking about Morikawa. Any interest in Scottie Scheffler, another ball striking type guy, as a potentially longer shot at 90-1.
Boy, where did he end up?
He's 90-1.
Scotty's not too far. He's in my top 20.
Okay.
90-1's not bad. Yeah, and he's another
just pure ball striker. That's it.
Yeah, there's kind of this like group of these younger guys that every week they come up high. Maybe I will have to add him.
Okay.
You know, I'm not putting much on these 100 to 1, 90 to 1, you know, 75 to 1 guys. And boy, it is super fun when they're in the mix on Sunday. There's nothing like the Sunday sweat. So
no,
Scotty, I think the only what's the knock that's keeping him down?
His short game's terrible.
His short game, his approach isn't great, and he's a little worse on the bogeys. So I mean, he's still top 20. He does some things great. Good off the tee. Good ball striker. Yeah, I don't mind that at all.
So when I'm setting up my DFS sheet, I try to get key stats for each event. You were talking about doing the same thing. So what's the process for you in determining which key stats you want to look at for that weekend's upcoming event?
You know, I try to keep some notes from last year, which is tough because I wasn't betting until the Masters last year. Like, this is like my first full cycle of actually betting golf, kind of actually trying more than just tailing along with some buddies that give me some hot tips, you know. But I bet every tournament. I do a lot of head-to-heads, which I honestly, I think that's where the money is anyway. It's so, like, outrights are sexy.
Yeah.
But head-to-heads is where the money's at. I did very well on those last year. So until we do get to the Masters, I'm kind of just doing what I did last year. And there's a lot of good writers out there. There's a lot of good information where you can find some good course previews. And you start reading about the course. You read about, you know, what other people think is important. And I like to get a few different perspectives on that and start putting it together. It's a longer course, but the par fives are super easy. If there's people that can attack par fives that aren't afraid of par fives, they can go after some eagles there and score on those. So, you know, those are guys that are going to make the cut and end up on the leaderboard on Sunday. So, I mean, that had to be a big part of it. They have to just, it's not going to be one of those birdie fests where somebody's winning at 22 under. You know, you got to look at some past history of what happened at that course, and it's going to be something maybe in the 10 to 15 range. So somebody can score on the fives, avoid some bogeys, try to end up some, you know, 3-4 under per day, end up at 12 under on Sunday, get it done for me.
So. All right. I like that. So Andy, before we let you go, I suck at XFL betting, so I'm going to ask for your opinions here. Got some XFL championship odds over at FanDuel Sportsbook. Houston plus 185. St. Louis is plus 350 with Jordan Ta'amu. Any teams you like at their current numbers, or any teams you're looking to broadly buy in the coming weeks? Because I have no feel for the XFL, so I'm going to lean on you here and let you do this instead of me.
Yeah, I've made future bets along the way, so I feel good where I'm at. Like, I had Houston off the get-go. I posted them on Twitter at like 7.5 to 1, and I got a bunch of DMs like, hey, it's FanDuel. Like, I'll give you guys some shine. Somebody said FanDuel has 12 to 1. It was a guy out on the East Coast. Yeah. And I'm like, shit, I might have to go down to Iowa. The offshores just didn't have that number. But I found some 9 to 1 on Houston. So I'm sitting pretty there. I bought into St. Louis when it was a little lower. I think I got a 9 or 10 to 1 there. So I have the two best outrights. Like, I'm not excited about adding it. You know, it depends. Right. If somebody doesn't have a portfolio like that, obviously it might be a time to add. And I kind of looked at LA, like, because they're 1-3, but it's 15 to 1. I've seen some flashes from Johnson. Like, they have a decent quarterback. They have a decent offense. They're 1-3, but they have a positive touchdown ratio or net touchdowns. Like, they can be good, and I think maybe, you know, it's Houston's conference or whatever they're calling the two splits, however they made it. I think, you know, Houston's gonna run away with it, but another team will make the playoffs, and five wins might get it done. They get Seattle twice, they get to host Tampa. Like, they just really got to find one more win and get those done. They could get five, maybe six wins, get into the playoffs. So 15 to 1 is a little heavy. Like, I don't think I could buy into any other teams at the current prices. Yeah. It's just tough. They've priced the good teams good. And, man, Houston already has a couple nice wins. They beat St. Louis. You know, they got the win down in Dallas. It is what it is with their price. And that's where it should be. Like, it should be the favorite.
I think if I were in your position there, even outside of my self-imposed XFL embargo betting, I would also be good to stand pat with Houston and St. Louis, but also with LA. Like, Josh Johnson leads the league in adjusted yards per attempt, so I can buy into that one as well. That is Andy Molitor. Make sure you follow him on Twitter to get that conference tournament breakdown at AndyMSFW, and check him out as well on the Deep Dive podcast. Andy, it was awesome to get you on here today. Really appreciate your time. Good luck with all the conference tournaments, and hopefully we can talk to you again sometime.
Yeah, thanks a lot, guys. A lot of fun. Like I said, I'm a listener. It's cool. Yeah. another Minnesotan talking about the Knobloch. That was Dollar Dome Dog Night.
That was the main issue. Wednesday.
Yeah, those people could get dollar hot dogs, and they were just whipping them at Knobloch. So, no, it's been a lot of fun, guys, and hope you have good luck here in March as we move towards the tournament. And I know Ed's super involved in that with his big game theory tournament guy. I had a lot of fun talking about that last year.
Yeah. The two things I remember being chucked from the upper deck at the Dome, dollar hot dogs and Terry Tiffy bobbleheads. Those are the two things, for whatever reason, I remember getting chucked from the upper deck. So I'll happily talk about Dollar Dog Night any night. Absolutely, Andy. Well, thank you so much. We appreciate it and good luck.
Thanks, guys.
Covering the future.
Once again, a big thank you to Andy Molitor for swinging by and breaking down those the XFL for me, and also talking some golf and men's college basketball as well. Find him on Twitter at AndyMSFW to get that breakdown of the conference tournaments. And Ed, like I said, music to my ears to get a Minnesota accent here on the podcast. For people who don't know, though, the Minnesota accent is mostly northern Minnesota, because I'm from southern. I'm basically Iowan. Or Iowegian, I don't know, whatever. I'm basically from Iowa. So, like, I don't really have, like, as much of the accent, but if you're from northern Minnesota, it's thick. Like, my uncle is from just south of the Twin Cities. You would think he was in the movie Fargo. So, like, it's very variable based on where you are, which is, I think, very interesting.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, he's clearly from the Midwest, so it's great.
We got to get a Youper on here sometime so we can check all the boxes and figure all that stuff out for sure. Ed and I always preach searching for the best value in betting on games, and look no further than the odds comparison our engineers have developed over at numberfire.com. OddsFire is the premier odds comparison experience across major bookmakers in the regulated U.S. market. Compare odds, quickly identify the best value, and even examine first-party FanDuel data all in one place. Never settle, always get the best odds. Check out the experience for free now on NumberFire or at OddsFire.com. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER. Let's dive now into covering the future. Ed, March Madness just around the corner. What are you talking about today here on Covering the Future?
Yeah, so I wanted to talk about some of the work I've been doing in college basketball analytics, and particularly my market rankings. So what this does is it takes closing spreads from the markets and adjusts for who you played to get a ranking for teams, and it's also a predictor in the usual sense that, you know, you get a prediction. Every team has a rating, and you get a prediction by subtracting the ratings of the two teams. And I've worked a bunch of my college basketball model in the run-up to March, and what I found is that this market component is the most predictive. So it actually has the most weight, more than when I look at points per possession adjusted for schedule. Like, this is the biggest driver in my model right now. So, and this is pretty consistent with what Ken Barkley was telling us about, some of the stuff that he had. He said he was essentially doing an ELO rating based on the markets. It's going to be similar to what I have, maybe a little bit weighted more towards later games, although I do weight my market rankings are the one place where I do weight recent games more than games long in the past. But based on what I've done with my market rankings, I can see why his stuff was working on opening lines so much. So what I thought we'd do is go through top 10 teams in my college basketball market rankings. I'll make some points here and there and just compare and contrast with what we have in terms of adjusted efficiency, which I have as well. So top team is Kansas. I think they're going to enter the tournament as the favorite. So I think they should be the favorite. The second team is Duke. Also a team that I think checks a lot of boxes in terms of having the talent to win the tournament. They actually haven't done quite so well in the court lately. I mean, they got blown out at North Carolina State, lost to Virginia this past week. So when I look at them from an efficiency perspective, they're seventh. Coach K always has talent, so you definitely can't count them out. Three and four is where I think it gets a little bit interesting. I have Gonzaga at three. Phenomenal job by Mark Few. He lost two pretty incredible NBA players in Riri Hachimura and Brandon Clark, two guys that are doing very well in their rookie seasons. And he still has this team near the top of college basketball. Just a really impressive job. And four, Michigan State. You know, if I would have told you especially before Saturday when they beat Maryland on the road, that Michigan State was the fourth best team in my numbers, I think a lot of people would be pretty skeptical about that. But that's what the markets are saying. I'm going to have a lot more to say about this team before the start of the tournament. Preseason AP number one. Obviously, that was part of that was Joshua Langford, who's not playing with us anymore. But we'll get to them more in a little bit. Michigan State is actually ahead of Baylor, a team that has been very good this year. They're at fifth. Louisville at sixth. Maryland's at seventh, which I think is pretty interesting. Remember, the recent games are weighted more than games at the beginning of the season. Maryland was a much bigger favorite in the markets. I think they were a 2.5-3 point favorite in the markets than I had them in the prediction. So they're getting helped by that. I think it's a very good team. It looks like a more engaged Maryland team than I've ever seen under Mark Turgeon. So I think they're a very interesting team as well. At eight, I have West Virginia, fourth Big 12 team in there, and they are definitely no slouch at all. Ninth is Florida State, and then 10th is Arizona. Arizona is a team that is very volatile. They have three first-round draft picks as freshmen on that team. So they're going to be a very high-ceiling team that could lose in the round of 64. So they're going to be a super interesting team as well. So two teams that you will notice that are not in this top 10 are Dayton and San Diego State. So that's basically saying that the markets wouldn't favor them over any of those top 10 teams heading into the tournament. It's obviously a different story efficiency-wise. Dayton is third. When I look at adjusted points per possession, they have one of the best offenses in the nation. Very good three-point shooting team. San Diego State is sixth. They were actually much higher before losing to UNLV within the past couple weeks. So I hope that gives you a sense for, you know, what's going on with my college basketball numbers, what we can expect heading into the tournament. And we'll talk a lot more about this over the next 2 weeks.
I think it's very interesting that the futures market aligns better with your efficiency numbers than it does with the market numbers, because you would think markets would correlate, but they don't, because West Virginia is 40-1. And Michigan State's 20-1, right. They were longer than that when you were on Michigan State like a month ago,
did I do a segment? I couldn't remember if I did a segment.
You didn't do a segment on them specifically. You mentioned them, and I said, hey, what do you think of Michigan State? I think they were at like 30 or something like that. They're 20 now. So you were ahead of the curve of Michigan State, but it's weird to see West Virginia on a single game basis grading out so well, but being 40-1. You would think that the markets would correlate more than that, but I think that also could provide value to go against what the straight up efficiency numbers are saying, because clearly these numbers are accounting for the efficiency numbers that you have.
In some sense, right? Yeah. I mean, there definitely are differences. Sure. You know, another one. So Kentucky's 12th in these market numbers. My numbers have consistently liked Kentucky more than the lines in the markets at this point. So I'm always interested in the consistency of markets, right? And we can always check that by like doing this analysis on the closing lines and then projecting forward for the tournament. And, you know, oftentimes they're not consistent. And we find that in football as well.
Right.
So I think that's definitely a place for opportunity.
Awesome. Looking forward to that for sure. For my Covering the Future, I want to talk some NASCAR today, because I think this weekend's race is honestly fascinating, because going into this week, I was expecting to be buying low on the Joe Gibbs Racing car, specifically Kyle Busch, Martin Truex Jr., and Denny Hamlin, because that team has struggled through the past two races, and I thought people would be down on them. But it's a new package this week. It's a wildly different package than the past two races, and these cars cleaned up on this track type last year. Then I saw the odds at Westgate and saw, oh no, we are not buying low on Joe Gibbs Racing. They are still very in on them. All three of those drivers are 6-1 or shorter based on the odds at Westgate. So there's no buy low window there unless the odds wind up being longer elsewhere. So flagging those three, but based on these odds, no chance. But there is a buy high chance somewhere else. And right now, if we look at my model, it has five drivers grouped at the top in a tier of their own for this race. It's the top three cars at JGR, Kyle Busch, Martin Truex Jr., Denny Hamlin. The odds align with them. Same thing is true for Kevin Harvick. He is third in my model, but he's also 6-1. The fifth guy in that top tier before there is a drop-off is Ryan Blaney. He is actually a tenth of a point, like very close, in my model behind Harvick and Hamlin, but he's 12-1, and they're both 6-1. And that's a pretty enticing value to me, because if you've been watching NASCAR this year, you probably understand why Blaney is so high on this list. He has been super close to winning all three races so far this year, and they've been on three different track types. He was 2 feet short of the win in Daytona, then he was 2 laps short in Las Vegas, and then last week in Fontana, he was probably going to finish second behind Alex Bowman, but then he had a tire issue, he had to pit late, he ruined a lot of DFS lineups, but hey, you know, whatever, it's a new week. But the overall point here is that Blaney has been crazy fast, and my model has fully bought into it. He was awesome on these, he's been awesome so far this year, and he was also awesome on this track type in 2019. There were 7 races that I classify as being short and flat last year. Blaney was in the top 5 for 5 of those 7 races. He had a top 7 average running position in all 5 where he finished well too, so not fluky finishes, good races with good finishes. 2 of those were in Phoenix, which is where they are this weekend. In the first race, he actually led 94 laps and finished 3rd. He was 3rd in the fall race too. He had a 5th place average running position there, so he has elite current form, very good track history, very good on this track type, and my model thinks his odds should be much shorter than where they are. So this is based on the Westgate odds, because not a ton of places have NASCAR odds out as of right now, as of Tuesday, for Phoenix. So I would say check out specifically Denny Hamlin to see where he's at, because if you can get him at a longer number based on the past 2 weeks, hop on that. But if you get Blaney at 12-1 or even like 10-1, I would be fully in on that yet again. I've had Blaney as one of my win picks like every week so far this year, but we're going to go back to the well here once again. It's almost worked out, so we're going to try one more time. Ed, I know that was all probably gobbledygook.
No. So I just want to ask, though, right? Yeah. I mean, margin of victory is obviously crucially important when you're ranking teams. So with Blaney, like, you know, being 2 laps behind in one race is...
No, 2 feet.
Well, so, 2 feet.
Sorry,
one.
Two laps. He was leading with 2 laps left, and then there was a caution that came out. And his crew chief decided to have him pit, and a couple other drivers stayed out. And it was a tactical mistake, because enough drivers stayed out where, I mean, it did give Joey Logano the win, and I bet on Logano too, so like I was fine with it. But like, he would have had a win there. So I probably phrased it poorly. Margin of victory can matter, because like last week in Fontana, Alex Bowman put a butt whooping on the field, and like I want to make sure I account for that. So in a sense, yes, it does matter to me at least.
All right,
but yeah, it's a
cool.
It's been an interesting start for Blaney so far. I have lost money on him so far, but we're gonna keep on doubling down. We're gonna bank on that sample size argument you had before, because I think that he still, from a process perspective, makes too much sense for me to back off of, especially when I can still get him at 12-1. That is all that we have for today here on Covering the Spread. Ed, you mentioned the podcast coming back on the Football Analytics Show with your March Madness previews. I listened to those last year to help prep for our podcast that we had for March Madness, and I'm excited that they're back again this year.
Yeah, I'm excited as well, although it is a lot of work. I'm hoping to not die quite as bad as I did last year after that was all over. But it will, if you go to the Football Analytics Show, there'll be, you know, in the title, there'll be labeled Bracket Wisdom. So, and they should appear daily from Monday, March 9th until the start of the tournament.
That is outstanding.
A little plus minus about whether daily means on weekends as well. So we'll see how many episodes. Get done.
We have a show here called The Daily ISO, which does not go weekends, so I'm fully in favor of pretending weekends don't exist.
Right. Well, in terms of producing content, right?
Absolutely. Content doesn't exist in the weekends. No one reads it. I'm not going to produce it. That's just the way it goes. Go ahead.
I mean, people did listen to some of the weekend shows, but it was definitely a little bit down, so.
Yeah. Save yourself the effort, you know?
Yeah. So I also wanted to mention, I just posted the Ultimate Guide to Predictive College Basketball Analytics. I go through and get into the nitty-gritty of how you make predictions in college basketball, which not only applies to college basketball, but is very relevant for what I do in football as well. And then also look at the 4 factors and whether matchups in the 4 factors can help you predict games better. So I've gotten some pretty good feedback on that so far. So you can check that out at thepowerrank.com.
And then the book is at thepowerrank.net as well. And the podcast starting Monday will be at the Football Analytics Show. Follow Ed on Twitter at thepowerrank. I am at Jim Sonnes, J-I-M-S-A-N-N-E-S. You can also follow the FanDuel Podcast Network at FanDuel Podcast. Big thank you to Calvin Theobald, our video producer, for on the video side of things here today. Thank you, Cal, as always. And thank you to Andy Molitor for swinging by and breaking down some men's college basketball conference tournament play. Follow Andy on Twitter at AndyMSFW. Thank you to everybody for tuning in for today. Really appreciate all of you. Back again next week, probably talking more men's college basketball. We will talk to you all then, and good luck with your bets until that time. This has been Covering the Spread right here on the FanDuel Podcast Network.